Wow. De zaal zit vol. Spannend. Dames en heren. Namens de uitgeverij VBK België en Ambo Antos heet ik jullie allemaal van harte welkom. Mijn dank gaat ook uit naar de collega's van de Vooruit, vooral in het bijzonder Peter van Neden, die deze avond mede voor ons hebben mogelijk gemaakt. Het is dan ook een enorm plezier om met een volle zaal Jonathan Foer te kunnen verwelkomen. Maar ik kan nu al met zekerheid zeggen dat het een zeer mooie en verrijkende avond zal worden. Maar wie is hij eigenlijk? Velen spreken over het wonderkind van de Amerikaanse literatuur. Een jong literair talent. En dat klopt wel, vind ik, zelf persoonlijk. Hij heeft een intense en inventieve schrijfstijl. Steeds met diepgang, die tot uiting komt in de beschrijving van al zijn personages. En ja, zijn personages zijn levensecht en zijn dialogen zijn in al hun herkenbaarheid ontzettend briljant. En hij deinst er helemaal niet voor terug om op een hilarische wijze heilige huisjes omver te schoppen. De manier hoe hij uit een elkaar vallend Amerikaans gezin beschrijft, dat was werkelijk onovertroffen. Hier ben ik, is zijn nieuwe roman, en dat is geleden sinds 2005. Hij schreef eerder de succesvolle en bekroonde romans Alles is verlicht en extreem luid, als ook Ongelooflijk dichtbij en eveneens, dat mogen we ook niet vergeten, het succesvolle non-fictieboek Dieren eten. Nu, zijn nieuwe roman, onlangs verschenen, heeft heel wat positieve recensies gekregen in de pers. Ik moet eerlijk bekennen, ik was zelf hierdoor enorm geprikkeld en heb genoten van elke bladzijde. Iedereen die houdt van enige psychologische diepgang zal met het lezen van dit boek een terugblik werpen op zijn eigen leven, op het essentiële. Kortom, meer dan een verrijking. Dames en heren, ik heb het genoegen gehad om deze voormiddag en deze namiddag reeds kennis te maken met Jonathan Foer. Het is gewoon een heel bescheiden persoonlijkheid. Aangenaam, warm, hartelijk. En ik heb natuurlijk van de gelegenheid gebruik gemaakt om een klein stukje van Gent te kunnen zien en te bezoeken met hem. Hij heeft er enorm van genoten. Gent heeft heel wat te bieden op vlak van cultuur, voor evenzeer. Ik heb hem zelf zo ver kunnen brengen om vandaag in het Galgenhuisje, maar ook in het Reupelkot, toch eens te proeven van een goed Geneverken. Hij kent het helemaal niet, maar het was letterlijk op 2 minuten leeg. En hij vond het a little bit strong. Maar goed, dat was ook wel eens leuk om mee te maken. En wat we uiteindelijk nog gedaan hebben, vooraleer we naar hier kwamen, was de Cuberg d'Ons ook eens uitproberen. En het was very nice. Nu wil ik maar aangeven, hij is een fantastische, aangename man. En dat zal u weldra ook ervaren. U heeft het ook al door dat ik zelf van het Gentse ben en vooral supporteer voor de Gentse fans, dan dat het niet altijd in Antwerpen hoeft door te gaan. In een van zijn interviews zegt Foer, en dit vind ik toch wel heel treffend, het belangrijkste in het leven is thuis kunnen komen. Ik herhaal, het belangrijkste in het leven is thuis kunnen komen. In een van zijn interviews heeft hij dat meerdere keren herhaald. Ik persoonlijk vind dit zo'n krachtig statement en het is zo verfijnd. Het is de waarheid vaak, bij iedereen van ons. En dit is mijn inziens de kern waarop alles gebaseerd is in zijn nieuwe roman. Maar ik laat u dit zelf ontdekken tijdens het interview met Annelies. Foer zal ook een passage voorlezen uit zijn boek als afsluiter, En nadien, uiteraard, zal hij ook beschikbaar zijn om te signeren. Ja, spannend, hè? Hij staat hier klaar. Maar ik zou dan ook vragen, dames en heren, geef hem een big applaus, hè? Zoals ze het zeggen op zijn Gents, voor zo'n groot talent en geniet samen met ons van deze prachtige avond. Dank je wel.
A perfectly timed applause. Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Goedenavond, Gent en omstreken. Meet Jonathan Safran Foer. Great to have you.
Thank you.
Do you feel at home already a little bit?
No, I wouldn't say that. I feel, I don't like holding microphones, so I'd asked if they could have a stand, but the asymmetry is so weird. It makes me feel like I'm disabled or something, like I'm in a wheelchair.
That's okay. I'm most comfortable like this, so
okay.
You can relax completely. We were told you had a walk through Ghent this afternoon. What was your impression? Most people here are from Ghent, I should tell you.
Okay.
Probably some.
It's very beautiful.
Good.
I mean,
you had a Geneva, we were told.
Yeah, I don't know why that's a story, but I did. Yeah.
You drank it too fast, apparently.
You drank it too slow.
But you enjoyed it.
Yeah, all alcohol is enjoyable in its own way.
Okay. Very well. Maybe we should get one other thing out of the way before we delve into your new novel, because obviously that's why we're here. The Nobel Prize. How do you feel about a Nobel Prize for Literature for Bob Dylan?
I don't have terribly strong feelings about it, to be honest. It's 12 Swedish people in a room who come to a decision by some mysterious process. You know, good for him, I guess. It's there may be people I think are I would rather have seen win it, but
like whom, for example?
I would have loved to see Philip Roth win it, but you know, Bob Dylan has meant a lot to an awful lot of people. I suppose there's something a little bit unusual about the fact that he's, you know, not a I don't know that he's a self-described writer. Mm-hmm. You know, there are a number of books that have very musical qualities, but they wouldn't win music awards. I assume he won it for his lyrics, which have very literary qualities, but they're not literature per se. But then again, I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. I mean, it's good for him.
Okay, that's a clear answer. Thank you for that. We're here to talk about Here I Am. And it's about 10 years since you published your last novel. Of course, you've published other things in between. We'll go into that as well. But why has it taken you so long?
Have you ever written a novel?
I have, in fact.
How long do they take you?
It took me 10 years.
So why
but
did it take you 10 years?
I am not here as a novelist today. I'm just asking questions.
Why did it take me 10 years? So there are a lot of answers I could give, like I was working on other things. I wrote Eating Animals. I wrote a couple of sort of art books. I had two kids. My older son is exactly the same age as there was time between my novels, so which is maybe a coincidence, but probably not. But the truth is, I'm proud of Eating Animals. I'm as proud of it as I am of my novels. I'm very proud of the kind of father that I was, have been, am. But those things didn't stop me from writing a novel. I have a particular like attitude about writing or perspective on writing, which I don't think is good or bad, but it's my own. I have friends who are writers who have a very different way of writing, where they think of each book as a kind of project. Like, this book I'm going to make about, you know, touring with a rock band, and this book is going to be a Vietnam War allegory, and this book is going to be science fiction genre. And somehow, like, the accumulation of these books is going to sum to a sensibility. I just don't think about books that way, and I can't think about books that way, even when I've wanted to. I always have a voice that's telling me as I write, this is the last thing you're ever going to write. And I don't mean it in the sense that I'm going to die anytime soon, because I don't suspect I am, although nobody suspects he is. And I don't mean it in the sense that I'm not going to write another book, because I assume that I will. But just in the most literal and straightforward sense, that the person who is writing this book is not going to write another book, which is a true statement. Mm-hmm. You know, the next book that I write will be written by somebody who's a little bit different, because I've changed, because the world has changed, my tastes have changed, because of the experience of having written the previous book. So when I look back at my older books, I'm proud of them, I'm not embarrassed, but I know that I have a closer relationship to their author than does anybody else in the world, but I don't feel like it's me. Mm-hmm. I had a weird experience. I was just in London, and the BBC does a kind of book group thing where they pick a book, and there's an audience that comes for a kind of reading group that's live on the air, and so I did that with Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close. I hadn't even looked at the book in probably 10 years. So, you know, as I was on my way in, I had to just, like, refresh myself for very basic plot points.
Did you like it? Did you like the book? Was it any good?
Well, I didn't read it. I just flipped through it. But that's a very complicated question.
Okay.
That may have been a simple answer that I just gave. But, do you like hearing your voice on answering machines? You ever had that experience, hearing your own voice on somebody's answering?
Voicemail? There's like this distance or this.
You know it's you.
Recognize it.
You know it's you, but it's not the you that you think you sound like. So this was like hearing my 10-year-old voice on an answering machine. So I felt very estranged from it, and I didn't like the experience at all.
No. So, but you are who you are when you write, while you write that particular novel. That's what you're saying. But you never doubt that you are a writer. It's not that you say, okay, I'm writing this book, and whether or not I will write more or another novel, that's not in question. Or is it?
I don't think it is anymore, but it was. It used to be. You know, my first book was, I worked very hard on it, but there was a way in which it was a kind of an accident, almost. I wrote the first draft of it when I was in college.
And this is about Everything is Illuminated, right?
Yeah. And at that point in time, it's very strange to even think about this, but we didn't have internet access in our dorm rooms in college.
There was a time like that, young people.
There wasn't wireless or anything like that. And so what you would do is you would go to in the basement of the building, there was something called a computer lab, where there were like lots of computers organized around it, around the like periphery of the room, and you would check your email there once a day, maybe, or once every 2 or 3 days, because how often did one really need to check email? And it was also where we would do our printing, because nobody had printers in their rooms. And so you would put your print job into a queue. You know, you would see, like, okay, so this person has to print 3 pages of an abnormal psychology paper, and this person needs to print 4 pages of a comparative literature paper, and then I'll do my thing. And I remember being in the computer lab, watching the 3 pages come out, watching the 4 pages come out, and then 400 pages came out that were my novel. And everyone in the room was like, what is this? What is going on here? And I was one of those people. I was like, what is going on here? Because I hadn't exactly remembered doing that. And a lot of writers I know have that experience with their first books. They have a quality of like falling from the sky. And my second book kind of fell beside it from the sky. I would have thought that it would have been a process that would require a lot more deliberation and willpower and choice, but it just didn't. I think maybe in part because it was borrowing from the energy of publishing my first book or that experience, or I was just young enough or naive enough or myself enough that there was like, I had a lot of creative energy that only wanted ventilation. Like I didn't have to generate it, I didn't have to seek it. I just had to find a good way to let it out and then it would come out. And then after that book, which is when my first child was born, almost exactly when that first, when that second book, excuse me, Extremely Loud came out, I just didn't have that anymore. Something changed inside of me and it was no longer a boulder rolling down an incline. It was like having to go up an incline. And so in that period, which lasted about, let's say 7 years between finishing one book and starting this book, properly starting this book, I worked on a whole bunch of different things. And I got quite far into a whole bunch of different projects, like 200 pages, 250 pages. But the problem was I would stop caring at some point. And because of the perspective, the way that I think about books that I described, I don't want to force myself to finish something that I've stopped caring about. People often ask at readings about process, like, do you try to write a certain number of words a day, or a certain number of pages, or for a certain number of hours? And if I ever reach the point of having to force myself to do it, then there, I would have no chance of writing something good, and probably no chance of even finishing it. The hardest thing about writing is just the same thing about, it's also what's hardest about relationships or hardest about anything you do, which is caring over time. Everything in the world makes you want to care less as time passes because you get used to it and you get numb to it, or because your tastes start to change or you become interested in other things. So it took
but
me a
little... But with this one, you stuck with this one. This one was close to your heart, was what, there was something in this book that drove you on.
There was.
That made you finish the project, or not the project, the novel.
Yeah, yeah. There was. And when I did finish it, I felt really happy. And in a way, it was a kind of unique happiness in my life. And it wasn't because I thought the book was good. I didn't even think in those terms. I still don't really think in those terms. The term doesn't even mean anything. But I was so gratified to be able to say, I got to the end without caring less. And that was my goal. That actually was my ambition. And it just took me a long time to find material that would, that I could have that relationship with.
But this brings us seamlessly to one of the themes in the book, I think, when you say you have to care for something over time, and that's hard, that's not self-evident in any case, because there are three main strands that I discern in this book, storylines, so to say. There's the story of a family that we follow over the course of 4-ish weeks, 1 month, so to say. There is a big disaster, natural disaster happening in the Middle East that has its consequences also for the family. The main characters in the story, and there is the son of the family, the oldest son, who lives a parallel life in a virtual reality called Other Lives. Those are the main lines, so to speak. But maybe we should start with the title, because it's so prominent. Hier ben ik, here I am, has a lot of references, lots of resonance as well. But maybe you can tell us where it comes from first, basically.
I can. It just occurred to me I hadn't thanked you for coming, and I hadn't thanked Peter and the other hosts for having me. Okay. I was here about 5 or 6 years ago for Eating Animals, and I had such a wonderful experience. It was such a happy experience. And I said to Peter at the time, I really want to come back. I hope I can come back. But I have a feeling it might be a while. And it was a while. And I was telling Peter earlier that last time I was here, after I did the reading, I was in the bathroom peeing at a urinal, as people do.
As one does in a bathroom? Yeah.
And someone was peeing at the urinal next to him, and he turned back, and he gave me a pat on the shoulder, and he's like, that was a great reading. There's a scene in my book, which I may read in a minute, that now that I think about it, was probably inspired by that exact event.
Great.
Yeah.
We'll sure make time for you reading that scene.
But joking aside, I really am happy to be here. And I've now done readings for 6 weeks, 2 months, you know, around America, other places in the world. And you see different like efforts to engage literary culture. And it doesn't go without saying that people will read books in the future. It really doesn't. It doesn't go without saying that literature can compete with screens. You know, there are a lot of reasons to worry. But when you're at an event like this, which is only this way because of how it was organized, you know, it makes you very grateful for the organizers. So I wanted to make a point of saying thank you. What did you ask me? The title.
Yeah. Yes, very plain, simple question, yeah. But
so
a big
the title
one,
refers to a passage in the Bible when Abraham is asked to sacrifice Isaac, and that passage begins, and then God put Abraham to the test. He said, "Abraham." Abraham said, "Here I am," and God said, "I need you to sacrifice your beloved son." So the obvious interpretation of that is that the test was to sacrifice Isaac. But another way to read it is that the test was, how will you respond when called? You know, will you say, "Give me 5 minutes"? Will you say, "What do you need? Who is it?" Or will you say, "Here I am, unconditionally present, without reservations. I don't need to know what you're going to ask. The answer is going to be yes." And then a few sentences later in the story, he's leading Isaac, his son, out up Mount Moriah for the sacrifice. And Isaac starts to like catch, he feels like, hey, something's weird here. We have all the makings of the sacrifice except for the animal. And so he says, "My father," and Abraham says, "Here I am." And it's a very poignant moment, but it's also paradoxical because you can't be unconditionally present for a God who wants you to kill your son while being unconditionally present for your son. You just can't hold both of those identities devoutly. And so I took that idea of these identity paradoxes and brought it into a contemporary setting in Washington, D.C., in the present. And I think that those paradoxes are something that probably everyone in this room has a version of. I have versions of them.
Conflicting roles, conflicting identities, conflicting demands made upon you.
Yeah, like to be in a relationship with somebody and to be an individual, you know, to be a parent and to be a professional. Maybe some people have religious values and secular values that are in competition. And usually it doesn't really matter that much. You can negotiate the two. But sometimes something will happen when you have to make a kind of ultimate choice at the expense of one identity. So the book is structured to force choices. First, there's a cell phone that's discovered that reveals an affair. And then there's this earthquake, which precipitates a war that gets so bad that the prime minister of Israel asks all Jews between the ages of 15 and 55 to come to Israel to fight. And so, you know, until this moment, Jacob, the hero, has been both in his marriage and outside of his marriage. You know, here I am and here I am. And now he reaches this moment when he has to decide which he is and will be. And regarding Israel, he's had two identities, or more than two identities. You know, at cocktail parties, when some Gentile friend will say something critical of Israel, he'll feel this reflexive need to defend it. But then when he's with his Jewish friends at like a Chinese restaurant, he'll feel a reflexive need to be critical of Israel. And he doesn't really know, in either case, like, where exactly is he vis-a-vis his marriage or his religious identity or Israel? And we don't know in our lives where we are until something forces us to declare where we are, which is a rare thing. You know, we get little versions of it maybe on like big birthdays, or some people might feel it on New Year's. We get it when somebody is sick. That's an occasion oftentimes, like really sick. Often it's bad news, you know, that compels us to say, "I am this at the expense of that." And it's like a very poignant predicament.
The main character you mentioned, his name is Jacob. Just a brief sketch. He abhors exposed guilt and he struggles with discovering the promise of a felt life isn't a lie. Well, he hoped that it wasn't going to be a lie, and he finds out it is sort of a lie, and he finds himself in the great flatness, it's kind of called in the book. And there's Julia Block, his wife, and their inner lives were overwhelmed years into the marriage by all the living, and they're balancing overreaction with repression and find that parenthood is basically cleaning up. This is summarizing hundreds of pages in a couple of your lines about these main characters. There are their three children, grandparents as well, Irv and Deborah, and great-grandfather Isaac. You choose this very particular Jewish family, specific Jewish family in Washington, D.C. What appealed you about this setting? Why did you decide to go for this story frame?
Well, you know, I could say a couple of things. One is I don't know that I actually decided at any point. The way I write doesn't feel like that. It feels like being open to a process where I sort of pursue what's interesting to me, and it leads me to different places. Oftentimes it leads me to dead ends. I mean, almost all the time it leads me to dead ends, and sometimes it doesn't. I think there are probably reasons why, being open, I would be led to Washington, D.C. I grew up there. It's a pretty obvious
one. You know it well.
What's that?
You know it well, obviously, then.
I know it well, although knowing it well isn't always a good thing or isn't even attractive. But in this case, I suppose I had always imagined writing something about the place that I came from. And so much of the book is about Americanness, and Americanness with relation to Jewishness or with relation to Israel, or just Americanness as an identity. They are a Jewish family, but they're primarily an American family. And Washington is the capital of America, so it's a great symbolic center, you know, to place them.
It's interesting that you say they're primarily an American family and not a Jewish family, because that's one of the questions in the book. Which one are they? But to you, it's obvious.
I maybe made it sound more obvious than it is. I'm sort of surprised I just said it like that, actually. Maybe I get defensive, you know, about that issue. Like, it's funny, when I finished the book and I started giving it to people to read, to friends, to my editor, people often said to me, like, wow, it's a really Jewish book. I'd say, really? I had absolutely no idea. Absolutely no idea. Wasn't on my radar whatsoever. I thought it was a very Jonathan book, and
which it is probably also.
Well, Jewishness is a part of me, you know. I mean, that's one of the odd things about writing, is when you encounter what is a part of you and what is a big part of you, because it's not always what you suspect. I had a funny experience the other day when I was at home, sort of in between little trips, and I often will play word games with my kids or trivia games, just stuff to like keep everyone's brain moving. And we were at breakfast and we were playing trivia. And I asked my younger son, who is 7, if he could name 5 kinds of dinosaur. And he got very excited and proud, because of course that's an easy question. He said, you know, Tyrannosaurus Rex, you got Tyrannosaurus, you got your Rex, you got your T-Rex. And I am not evolved enough to just let that go. And I, no, those are the same dinosaur. And we made peace. But then he said to me, did you ask me that question because there's a dinosaur on the back of my T-shirt? And I said, really? I hadn't seen it. And he said, yeah. And he turned around and he showed me. And it was early in the morning. I just hadn't seen his back yet. And the front of the shirt was completely nondescript. It's just a white T-shirt. So I can say to you, as I said to him, with absolute perfect honesty, I did not see the dinosaur. But we both know that the truth is I saw the dinosaur. I just didn't realize that I had seen the dinosaur. It fell into that huge category of things that you've seen without knowing that you've seen, which I think is much, 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 much vaster than the things that you've seen and know you've seen. And there are things you've heard without knowing you've heard. And then it gets kind of weird with thoughts you've had without knowing you've thought them, or feelings you've had without knowing you've felt them. And my writing, I think, and I hope, like, appeals to those kinds of experiences, those that are not direct observations, but the things that are happening in the margins that, if you are open to allowing them in, will come in. And so one of the side effects of that kind of writing is you start to, when you have a book to to look at, you start to see all of the like dinosaurs on the backs of t-shirts in your life. And a huge one for me has been Jewishness. Mm-hmm. Like, I didn't think
only
it was
you
there.
Weren't aware of it that much, that Mm-mm. explicitly. Yeah.
No,
but does it bother you that people read the book like that? Because reference has been made in some of the reviews or by readers of, you use a lot of dialogue, for example, a reference has been made to Woody Allen, or it has been said some scenes are remind us of Philip Roth in some way. Do you mind at all, or can you see it yourself, or how does that work?
I don't give it a huge amount of thought. I don't read reviews, and I don't, you know, writing is not at all like thinking about writing. They're just two completely different things. There's a saying that I love, which I very well might have said when I was here 5 years ago, a bird is not an ornithologist. You know, just because you are something doesn't mean that you are a student of it or can explain it or even that you have will to do it. And mm-hmm. There's something confusing about writing because it's the only art form that is created in the same language in which it's critiqued. So nobody goes to like a concert and then like reviews it by playing a song, or like walks out with a friend and starts like playing competing violins with their friend. And you don't go to an art show and make a little painting to talk about how you felt. You use English, or in your case, Dutch, or perhaps French, or even German. And
you're well informed. But that's the thing, right? There's that aspect, which is indeed confusing. But on top of that, you are considered a highly intelligent and intellectual and reflective kind of person. I don't know if that's the right English word, but someone who thinks about things and the world and writing too. So it isn't that odd a question, perhaps. Not to say that you have to have an answer, but or that you have to analyze it that way.
I hope I am those things. Maybe I am, maybe I'm not. I hope I am, but I'm not when I'm writing. I know that I'm not.
That's a different zone.
Yeah, it may be that a basketball player can explain like his anatomy of a like a jump shot, or the physics of a jump shot, and how the ball arcs and why like his muscles would operate in a certain way. He's not thinking about those things when he's playing basketball. It's like an intuitive thing. And for me, writing is very intuitive. And you know, there's a point at which I become an editor rather than a writer, and then it's a little bit different because I start to think about how to make use of things and how to be efficient and how to make like concessions to the form and how to be accessible and all of that.
So you can read your own texts with a cold eye?
No, never. But I can read it with the eye of like of trying to be a novelist rather than just like self-expression. They're different things.
Mm-hmm. Different job too. Would you agree that although this book is a very different book from the first two novels, that there is still an element of quest that runs through all three of them? But in this one, the quest is really internalized, is an internal quest, someone trying to find his place in the world, but also define his relationship towards himself?
I would agree, but I would also probably say every book is that. You know, it's hard to think of a book that you couldn't describe as a character's quest, an internal quest to find him or herself. Mm-hmm. So my first two books are like the plot is driven by a kind of journey towards some destination to reveal some information, and that's not the case in this book.
That's why I mentioned the internalized, but I mean structure is different indeed. Huh?
Mm-hmm. No, it's a very, very different kind of book.
How is it different for you? How is it a departure from what you wrote before for you?
I think the first two books were interested in like big gestures and brightly lit things and made an effort to be charming probably and to make an impression. Just as, you know, young people want to make impressions. They're Like, I mean, I am still young, but when I was really young, I really wanted to make an impression. That was just so important to me. I wanted to be known. I don't mean known by lots of people. I mean just known by another, you know? I wanted to be valued. I think young people, it's hard to imagine the young person who is confident of his or her value, you know? Mm-hmm. That's something that comes a little bit later, if ever. And so writing was one outlet for exploring my own value and wanting to affirm it. And I think that this book is much less concerned with those things. It's quieter, it's probably humbler in certain ways. It's more investigates and tries to closely look at things. It stays with conversations inside of rooms. It's less stylistically experimental. I mean,
do you still use different forms? You use dialogue, you use speeches, you use texting, going back and forth. You play with all kinds of ways of communication that
people. I mean, I made it sound like it's less. It's actually, I think this book is a lot more than my mm-hmm. previous two books. I mean, first of all, it's twice as long, but it also is more like, you know, argumentative. It's more political. It's more sexualized. It's more invested in dialogue. I think it has anger in it, which my first two books really didn't. Mm-hmm. It allows an ugliness in that I think is true, and it's a truth that was missing from my first two books, perhaps in their effort to be likable. I'm not sure. I really
don't
know.
More true to you or to life or to...
To life.
Yeah.
You know, to life.
Because the book and what is described in it begs a question that every writer hates, that is not relevant, and that you're going to get anyway. That is, how autobiographical is this book? How inspired is it by what you've lived through as a person? You are recently divorced, and this book is about a marriage under a lot of pressure, and the main characters are forced to decide how they feel about each other and whether they carry on or not.
It's not autobiographical in the sense of the events in the book corresponding to the events in my life. There's some overlaps. There have been overlaps in all of my books. I don't feel more closely aligned with Jacob, the hero, than I do the heroes of my other books, or even other characters in this book, like Julia or Sam. When writing both of Julia's and Sam's sections, I felt very like personally expressive.
Sam is the oldest son, Julia's the wife.
Julia's the wife. That having been said, I do feel a personal closeness to this book that I didn't feel with my other two. Maybe because, there are probably a lot of reasons, but one of them might be that this book is almost entirely in the third person, and my first two books are largely or almost entirely in first person voices. So with those books, I was like throwing my voice into somebody else's mouth, you know, mm-hmm. or projecting myself through somebody else's experience. And with this book, there's a kind of perspective or sensibility that presides over it, which is close to mine. You know, I am not the characters, but I think that I am like the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There is a section that is the Bible that accompanies a TV show that Jacob is writing on secretly for years already. The series in the book is called Ever Dying People, and you have been writing on a TV series called All Talk in real life, in your life. So did you recycle All Talk and put it in a novel, or did it give you the idea for Ever Dying People?
So I worked on, there's a period, as I was talking about earlier, between these my two books when I just was a bit lost. You know, there's nothing that I really cared about all too much. And I got a phone call from a producer in America who I knew a little bit. He's the guy who produced the film of my second book. And he's a brilliant guy, really, really brilliant. And he said, would you like to adapt? I own the rights to this book. Would you like to adapt it? And I said, no, I don't want to adapt something. He said, okay, well, nice talking to you. And we hung up. And then the phone rang again. And he said, you know, would you want to write something original then? And I said, sure, you know. Like, if someone had said, like, you know, do you want to separate out the plastic and paper recyclables, I probably would have said, sure. Like, I was not going to say no to very much at that moment because I was looking for anything to do that wasn't novel writing. And I started to work on it, and I started to really like it. I liked the form, which is basically like writing a play, just a series of plays. And it was a very intimate experience. It was just like novel writing. I sat in my room and I wrote. I liked the characters that started to come out. I liked working in kind of episodically. And then it just took on a like momentum, and suddenly we had actors and we were getting ready to actually put it into production. We were maybe a month or two away. And I was in Denmark, just on a vacation, and it was during the summer. And it was like, I don't know about you, but I often have personal revelations when I travel. When I'm away from home, I find it much, much easier to have like a crisis moment, which is in a good way, not in a bad way.
You're more susceptible in a way as well to everything that's going on, maybe.
Yeah, yeah. And I just thought, wait, I don't want to do this. What was I thinking? You know, I like writing it, but I don't want to make a TV show. I don't want to have to actually go to a set and deal with all of these personalities, and it's kind of like running a business. And so I ended up not doing it. And so to come to terms with what you don't want to do begs the question, what do you want to do? And it was truly the first time that I can remember saying to myself, without any irony at all, or without like a little wink, you know, mm-hmm. like, I want to be a novelist. And that sounds crazy, because I'd published 2 novels, I'd traveled around the world, I had never, if somebody had said to me, when did you decide you wanted to become a novelist? I would always say, well, I'm still deciding, or like every morning I decide. And I would give answers that sounded probably a little obnoxious, but were true. It was really true.
Evasive at the least.
Yeah, but it was true. Like I didn't grow up wanting to be a novelist. I didn't write my first book wanting to be a novelist. And then I became a novelist. And then I became the author of 2 books, but I still hadn't made the decision. I hadn't caught up with the experience. But then, about 4 years ago, I did catch up with the experience.
And you accepted that you are a novelist, or was it a decision for you at that time?
No, it was a decision. Yeah. I mean, it was kind of one of these here I am decisions, because it was a decision at the expense of another identity. Up until that point, I was like a novelist, kind of, but I was kind of also not a novelist. And I was a writer, but I also taught, and I would also wrote nonfiction, and I was maybe going to do this TV show. And I never in life liked the feeling of being stuck. I'm claustrophobic, like spatially, and I'm claustrophobic emotionally or psychologically. I don't like being confined. And until that point, to say I'm a novelist felt confining to me. Mm-hmm. I just wasn't ready to do that. And then I was. And after I made that decision, this book started to come quite quickly. And I'd always had there's a saying I used to love, which is writing is like pulling teeth out of your penis. Like,
okay,
it's like,
come
it
again?
Is the most excruciating, horrible, painful thing you could possibly do. But I think I had that relationship. Is that
someone has teeth.
Yeah. I think part of what made it so difficult was my unwillingness to accept it, or to accept myself as a writer. And so I was in a constant state of maybe this, maybe that, you know? Like people...
Keeping the options open and sort of restlessness at the same time.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And then I'm sure it's not a coincidence that when I made that decision, not because anybody asked me to, but because I felt it, then writing became, first of all, it happened much more quickly. And it also became very happy. You know, right? There were a lot of moments in writing this book when I would have done anything not to write it, and I hated it. But when I think back on those 3 years, they're very joyful I really did like, I had a lot of fun writing the book. And that's something we haven't really talked about yet. Like, it is a serious book in certain ways. It's political in certain ways. It's culturally specific. But it's also, I think, fun and funny.
Absolutely.
And I think...
entertaining.
Entertaining, yeah, I hope so.
Let's prove that. May I suggest you read an excerpt so everyone gets a flavor of what it's like in parts, because of course it's a big book with a lot of atmospheres and different scenes, obviously. And this is, then I take it from what you said earlier, inspired by Ghent, by this very, very place. You'll understand.
Yeah, by my gay bathroom experience. Okay. I have to explain what's going on here. So Jacob has gone to the airport to pick up some relatives who are coming into town for this family occasion, Sam's bar mitzvah, his oldest son's bar mitzvah, and he's picking up Tamir, his Israeli cousin. Tamir's about the same age as Jacob, like 42, but he's very different. He's muscular and hairy and tanned, and he doesn't take any shit from anybody, and he has no internal self-censoring mechanism. He just says it as it is, does whatever he wants to do. Jacob is more kind of vigilant and neurotic and a little bit paler, a little bit smaller. Jacob is at the airport with his middle son, Max, who's 10, and his father, Irv. So Irv is a political blogger who's kind of xenophobic, a little bit of a caricature. He is pro-Jew in every single context, without questioning. He's also a sympathetic character as the story develops. We spend a lot of time sort of laughing at him, and then we spend some time understanding him. So Jacob has gone into the men's room. A man his father's age was urinating beside him. His pee came out in bursts, as if from a lawn sprinkler. And to Jacob's unaccredited ear, it sounded like a symptom. When the man let out a small grunt, Jacob reflexively glanced over, and they exchanged the briefest of smiles before remembering where they were, a place where exactly one extremely brief moment of acknowledgement was tolerable. Jacob had the strong sensation that he knew this person. He often felt that at urinals, but this time he was sure, as he always was. Where had he seen that face before? Was it a teacher of his from grade school, or maybe one of the boys' teachers, or one of his father's friends? He returned to thoughts of babbling brooks and the slow death of a lower back whose demise, like so much else, he never considered until forced, and then it hit him. Spielberg. Once the thought appeared, there was no doubting it. Of course it was him. Jacob was standing, his penis exposed, next to Steven Spielberg, whose penis was exposed. What were the odds? Jacob had grown up, as had every Jew, in the last quarter of the 20th century under Spielberg's wing. Or rather, in the shadow of his wing. He'd seen E.T. 3 times in its opening week, all at the Uptown Theater, each time through his fingers as the bike chase reached a climax so delicious it was literally unbearable. He'd seen Indiana Jones, and then the next one, and then the next one. He'd tried to sit through Always. Nobody's perfect. Not until he makes Schindler's List, at which point he is not even he anymore, but representative of them. Them? The murdered millions. Well, no, Jacob thought, representative of us, the unmurdered. But Schindler wasn't for us, it was for them. Not the murdered, they can't watch movies. It was for all of them who weren't us, the goyim. Because with Spielberg, into whose bank account the general public was compelled to make annual deposits, we finally had a way to force them to look at our absence, to rub their noses in the German shepherd's shit. And God was he loved. Jacob found the movie schmaltzy, overblown, and flirting with kitsch, but he'd been profoundly moved. Irv denounced the choice to tell an uplifting Holocaust story, to give, for all intents and purposes, a statistically negligible happy ending generated by that statistically negligible of species, the good German. But even Irv had been moved to his limits. Isaac, who's the grandfather, couldn't have been moved more. You see what was done to us, to my parents, to my brothers, to me, you see? Everyone was moved, and everyone was persuaded that being moved was the ultimate aesthetic, intellectual, and ethical experience. Jacob was going to have to cop a look at Spielberg's penis. The only question was on what pretense. Every annual physical ended with Dr. Schlesinger kneeling in front of Jacob, cupping his balls, and asking him to turn his head and cough. That experience, I wonder if that's uniquely American, or if you have that here as well, that experience seemed to be universal and universally inexplicable among men. But coughing and turning one's head had something to do with genitals. The logic wasn't airtight, but it felt right, so Jacob coughed and he snuck a peek. The size didn't really make an impression. Spielberg was no longer shorter, wider, or narrower than most doughy Jewish grandfathers. Neither was he particularly bananaed or pendular, reticulated, light bulbish, reptilian, laminar, mushroomed, varicosey, hook-nosed, or cockeyed. I have to thank my little brother for that list of adjectives. I was writing this, I'm not done, I'm just remembering something. When I was writing this, I texted my little brother, and I said, listen, I need some adjectives to describe Steven Spielberg's penis. And absolutely no context. I didn't say, I'm writing a scene in a novel, da da da. I hit send, and then, I mean, milliseconds later, a stream of adjectives started coming back at me. And I used most of them. I don't even know. I literally don't even know what some of these words mean. Like laminar. I never looked it up. I just knew it was right somehow. Okay, so he wasn't any of these things, varicose, hook-nosed, or cockeyed. What was notable was what wasn't missing. His penis was uncircumcised. Now, Jacob had had precious little exposure to the visual atrocity that is an intact penis. And so that works differently in different audiences. And so wouldn't bet his life on what he saw. Actually, just one more aside, just because I was thinking about work differently in different audiences. I had an English friend once who came to stay in the States for a couple of months and stayed in my apartment for a couple of months when I wasn't there. And I checked in on him, how's everything going? Great. You found everything you need? Yes. He said, I have a question. I said, yeah. He said, why are all porn stars in America Jewish? I said, what do you mean? And he said, well, they're all circumcised. And I said, no, basically all Americans are circumcised. He's like, oh, okay. Also, Jews do it better. Mm-hmm. Okay, Jacob had precious little exposure to the visual atrocity that is an intact penis, and so he wouldn't bet his life on what he saw, and the stakes felt that high. But he knew enough to know that he had to look again. But though urinal etiquette forgives a greeting, and the cough might have been a passable alibi for the glance, there was simply no way to return to the scene without propositioning sex. And even in a world in which Spielberg hadn't made AI, that wasn't going to happen. So there were four options. One, he'd misidentified him as Steven Spielberg and misidentified his penis as being uncircumcised. Two, he'd misidentified him as Steven Spielberg and correctly identified his penis as being uncircumcised. Three, it was Steven Spielberg, but he'd misidentified his penis as being uncircumcised. Of course he was circumcised. Or four, Steven Spielberg wasn't circumcised. If he were a betting man, he'd have pushed his mountain of chips onto four. Jacob flushed, his face and the urinal, washed too quickly to accomplish anything and scrambled back out to the others. You are never going to believe who I just peed beside. Jesus, Dad, Max said. Close, Jacob said. Spielberg. Who's that? Tamir asked. You're serious? What? Spielberg. Steven Spielberg. Never heard of him, Tamir said. Give me a break, Jacob said, unsure as ever to what extent Tamir was performing. Whatever else could be said about him, Tamir was smart, worldly, and restless. But whatever else could be said about him, he was foolish, solipsistic, and self-satisfied. If he had a sense of humor, it was drier than cornstarch, which enabled him to practice a kind of psychological acupuncture on Jacob. Did a needle just enter me? Does it hurt? Is this all complete bullshit? He couldn't have been serious about never having heard of Steven Spielberg. It's impossible, and yet entirely possible. Oh, that's heavy, Irv said. Irv is the dad. And the heaviest part? Jacob leaned in and whispered, he's not circumcised. Max threw his hands into the air. What, did you kiss his wiener in the bathroom stall? Who is this Spielberg? Tamir asked. We were at urinals, Max. No, this can't be right, Irv said. I know, Jacob said, but I saw it with my own eyes. Why were your own eyes checking out another man's penis, Max asked. Because he's Steven Spielberg, Jacob said. Why won't someone tell me who this person is, Tamir said. Because I don't believe that you don't know who he is. Why would I pretend, Tamir asked, entirely believably. Because it's your bizarre Israeli way of diminishing the achievements of American Jews. And why would I want to do that? You'd have to tell me. Okay, Tamir said, calmly wiping the remnants of 6 packets of duck sauce from the corners of his mouth, whatever you say. He got up and headed in the direction of the condiments bar. You have to go back in and be sure, Irv said. You have to go in and introduce yourself. You will do no such thing, Max said, exactly as his mother would have. Irv closed his eyes and said, my core has been shaken. I know, Jacob said. I mean, what are we to believe? I know. All the while, we thought his Holocaust schlock was compensating for the Holocaust. Now it's schlock? It was always schlock, Irv said, but it was our schlock. Now, I have to wonder. Well, it's not as if he isn't Jewish. But Jacob couldn't finish the sentence, or he didn't need to. As soon as the fragment of the possibility entered the world, there was no room for anything else. I need to sit down, Irv said. You are sitting down, Max told him. I need to sit on the floor. Don't, Jacob said, it's filthy. Everything is now filthy, Irv said. In silence, they watched dozens of people balancing overstuffed trays, weave and dodge and never touch. Presumably, a higher life form would have its own version of David Attenborough. That person could make a great episode of a miniseries about humans featuring such hypnotic observing. Max whispered something incomprehensible to no one. Irv rested his head in his hands and said, if God had wanted us to be uncircumcised, he wouldn't have invented smegma. What? Jacob asked. I said, if God had wanted... No, I was talking to Max. I didn't say anything, Max said. What? Nothing. Irv said, Jaws is such a terrible movie. And then Tamir came back. They'd been too preoccupied by their speculations to notice how long he'd been gone. So here's the deal, he said. What deal? He has problems with urinary retention. He? Steve. Irv clapped his cheeks and squealed like it was his first visit to the American Girl flagship store. I can see why you assumed I wouldn't know who he is. Very impressive resume. What can I say? I don't watch a lot of movies. There's no money in watching movies. A lot in making them, though. Did you know that he's worth more than $3 billion? Billion with a B? Really? He had no reason to lie to me. But why did he have a reason to share? I asked. You asked him how much he's worth? Yeah. And you probably asked if he's circumcised, right? Yeah, I did. Jacob embraced Tamir. He hadn't meant to. His arm simply reached for him. It wasn't that Tamir had gathered the piece of information. It was that he had all the qualities that Jacob lacked and didn't want, but desperately missed. The brashness, the fearlessness where fear wasn't required, the fearlessness where fear was required, the giving of no shits. Tamir, he said, you are a beautiful human being. So? Irv begged. Tamir turned to Jacob. He knows you, by the way. He didn't recognize you, but when I mentioned your name, he said he'd read your first book. He said he considered optioning it, whatever that means. He did? That's what he said. God, if Spielberg had made a film out of that book, I'd exhume the lead, Irv said. Is he short-sleeved or what? Tamir jiggled his soda cup, freeing the ice cubes. Tamir? We agreed it would be funnier if I didn't tell you. We? Steve and I. Jacob gave him a shove, as spontaneous as the hug. You're bullshitting. Israelis never bullshit, Tamir said. Israelis only bullshit, Jacob said. We're family, Irv pleaded. Yes, and if you can't keep secrets from your family, who can you keep secrets from? Fine, so I emancipate myself from the family. Just tell me, please. Tamir scrapped the remaining lo mein from his bowl and said, before I fly back. What? I'll tell you before I go. You can't be serious. Could he be serious? I can, he said. Irv banged the table. Okay, I'll tell Max, Tamir said. An early bar mitzvah present. What he chooses to do with the information is his own business. You do know it's Sam's bar mitzvah, Max said, not mine. Of course, Tamir said with a wink. This is a very early bar mitzvah present. And then he put his hands on Max's shoulder and brought him close. His lips almost touching Max's ear, he whispered. And Max smiled, and he laughed.
you still have fun when you read that, no?
I mean, it's funny to me. I don't know how well the penis stuff travels, but it is funny to me, yeah.
It is, it is. You have a line in the book saying, Jacob thinking about himself and Tamir, if they were more like each other, they would form a reasonable Jew. Reasonableness and righteousness are also concepts that are quite present in the book. What is a reasonable Jew?
Well, I mean, it's a joke in the book that, you know, it's as if almost like, I don't know if it was Plato or Socrates, or Aristotle for that matter, is a Greek philosopher who talked about, you know, that couples were originally one person and they're broken apart and then they spend the rest of their existence is trying to refine their other halves. Israeli Jews and American Jews, the joke is implied in the book, are sort of like that. Like, each is half of a proper whole and separated by an ocean. And, you know, as I was saying, they have these very different characteristics, very different physical characteristics, oddly enough, even though they're only separated by a generation or two generations, and very, very different psychological characteristics which have developed in response to their environments. And each longs to be more like the other while also resenting the other for being that way.
Yeah, which is obvious in the relationship between Tamir and Jacob. Goes back well into the past when they were young. There's this earthquake that happens in the Middle East, and it hits Israel as well. What on earth gave you the idea for an earthquake in the Middle East?
There's actually a fault line in the Middle East, and I was in...
Like the one near San Francisco?
I've been there all over the world, but yeah. that is another
I
one.
I mean, that the awareness is there of this
oh,
fault
no, I don't
line,
think the awareness
not?
Is okay. really there. Earthquakes are very rare there, but when they come, they're quite powerful. And I was going to visit Jericho, and someone mentioned, like while we were in the car, the story of the walls of Jericho coming crumbling down in the Bible, and that maybe had something to do with a historical earthquake. I thought, that's sort of interesting. That's weird. And do you know the experience of you like get into bed at the end of a day, at the end of a long week, and you're just really tired, like existentially tired, and the apartment is kind of cold and the bed is very warm and cozy and you're just about to drift off. Like maybe you've already done that weird falling mm-hmm. thing and some idea will enter your mind and you think, that's an interesting idea. And you have two options. You could assume you will remember it the next day. In all of human history, nobody has ever remembered an idea like the next day. Or you could get out of bed and find a pen and paper and scribble it down. So, for me, being a writer is a lot like getting out of bed and scribbling it down over and over and over and over, both by making the effort to face the blank page every day, but also just in how I live. Like if I hear something that's interesting, because I am a writer, I will pursue it a little bit, even though in all great likelihood, you know, in the morning when you look at the ideas you write down, 9 times out of 10, you know, just like, why did I think that had value? But 1 out of 10 times, you say, I'm glad I wrote that down. So those are actually not terrible odds, you know? And so as a writer in my life, when something just like scratches at my head, I will, at the inside of my head, I'll pursue it. And I don't know why certain things appeal to me in that way and others don't, but I know when they do. And hearing about the earthquake was one of those things, and I ended up spending a day at the Geophysical Institute in Israel, and I talked to the guy who runs the earthquake preparedness. I stood with him in front of this amazing, like, wall-sized screen of the world, a map of the world, which showed all the earthquakes happening at any given moment. And there are earthquakes happening at every given moment. Mm-hmm. They're just very small. The way that they detect them is they have these sensors buried, I think every 10 miles or so, pretty much everywhere around the globe. And when the distance between them changes, they know that there's an earthquake going on, and they can tell how strong the earthquake is by how great the change in distance is between them. And I stood there with them just watching earthquakes happen all around, and I thought maybe this will be that 1 out of 10 things that is productive.
And it so happened that it ended up in the book in a quite important way, obviously. This idea, the choice that decision that Jacob has to make about his stance vis-a-vis Israel, is that a debate that is going on in the US, or is that a question that you find interesting yourself, that you are pondering yourself as well?
The relationship of American Jews to Israel. It's a kind of like latent debate. You know, it's something that is there and matters, but isn't really talked about a lot. I'm not aware of it actually coming up in many novels. I could maybe only think of one or two where it makes any appearance at all. It's like a lot of things, like, you know, there are moments when who we are is revealed. Like the US election is such a moment, and it will be revealed who America is in this moment. And the first reading that I did from this book was in Brooklyn, and it was in a theater in a synagogue. And so an awful lot of the people who were there were Jewish because it was in Brooklyn and because it was in a synagogue. And the interviewer asked the audience, just out of curiosity, how many of you would go if this were the situation? If the Prime Minister of Israel said, we need you in order to survive. And yes, some people raised their hand, some people didn't. What most people did was look around and like see who was raising their hand and who wasn't. And then the interviewer asked me what I thought about that response. And I said, I don't think anything about it. Like, it's not, all that people are raising their hands to express is who they want to think of themselves as being or how they want to be seen by others. Mm-hmm. Until the moment arises, the actual crisis, everything we say in anticipation of it is really...
Just talk.
It's just words. And so I wanted in this book to have these crises where there'd be moments of revelation. This is who I've been telling you I am this person, and now I'm going to show you that this is who I actually am.
You're called to really prove it or unprove it to yourself. Do you sometimes feel in this election that you are being called upon, that maybe you have to speak out more than you would otherwise do about how you feel about what's happening in the US at the moment?
I think we're okay, is what I would say. I don't think it's going to be close, ultimately.
You don't think it's going to be Trump?
No. I don't even think it's going to be close. And I didn't think that Britain was going to leave the EU, and I didn't think that Colombia...
There were a lot of people thinking that was not going to happen, so...
Colombia would veto the peace treaty with FARC. This one I really think is a fairly safe bet, but it's still alarming, and it's sad that we even have to talk about it. You know, that we've even reached the point where America has, as one of its two presidential candidates, somebody like him.
But you don't feel or haven't felt, I want to participate in the debate, or I want to make clear to whomever wants to know where I stand.
I don't think there's a very good way for someone like me to participate. My participation will look like, and I will participate, but it will look like the participation of my friends, which is I will go to like a phone bank in the week before and call undecided voters and talk to them. Maybe I'll go to Pennsylvania, Ohio, a state where that could go either way, and knock on doors. But if I were to write an essay, it would really be preaching to the choir, and it would have an aspect of narcissism as well. So when asked about it, I'm happy to talk about it and share, you know, what I think. But I'm wary of either assuming I know more than I do or that I am more important than I am. You know, I know America is very, very sharply divided now in such a way that I do not know anybody. I literally do not know anybody who knows anybody who is going to vote for Trump.
Okay.
So we are now in like...
In separate worlds,
yeah,
as it were.
And my audience as a writer, maybe not 100%, but something approaching 100% is going to, you know, be firmly in the Hillary Clinton camp.
A lot of this book, or a lot of what happens between Julia and Jacob, is about communication and how it falters or not. The irony, to me at least as a reader, is also in the fact that about Jewish people, it's being said that it's all about talk, 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 but not about necessarily saying what they really want to get off their chest. So there are walls in the communication, even if a lot is being said. Is that something that you, as a writer, felt, or, yeah, let me see if I can make this question more precise. It's writing and communicating about how difficult it is to write and communicate, especially within a community that that holds it in such high esteem, this verbosity, this brilliance with words. Is that something that attracts you in writing, the finding the right ways to say what you mean? Is it easier in a novel than in person?
Well, it's definitely easier in a novel because you can edit yourself in a novel and you can't edit yourself in life. You know, Everybody knows the feeling of, there's even a French expression for it, of leaving, there's probably a German one as well, but of leaving a conversation and then wishing you had said something different. Wishing that in the moment that you knew then what you know now, that little anecdote or that counter argument or the joke, whatever it is. So in a book, you do know then what you know now. You know, I can go back to the beginning and change it. And so life is always tick-tock, tick-tock, but in a book, time doesn't happen like that, or expression doesn't happen like that. So you get a second chance and a third chance and as many chances as you want until you say, this is now the best that I can do. A book is another kind of, like, here I am moment.
Manifestation, mm-hmm. Yeah. You are a person, I think, that's quite private, yet you are being talked about as well as a person, just being talked about your private life, who you are, who you're seeing, and so on. How do you manage that? How do you live with that? Because you published an email conversation with Natalie Portman that was then hotly debated and hotly discussed. Is that teasing this whole tension between the public and private that you cannot control, I imagine, as a person? Or is that just you saying, je m'en fous, I think this is a literary, interesting conversation and I want to share it?
I guess I don't have a whole lot of awareness of what you're talking about. I don't use social media at all. I know that, like, there are things that are hotly discussed. I've just never actually met somebody who hotly discusses these things.
Not in your face.
No, I just think it's like a dank little corner of the basement, basically. I do what I want to do. Like, you know, I've known Natalie since I was 20, something like that. Very, very long friendship. And she said, would you do this thing for me? I said, sure. And we couldn't be in the same place, so we just did manufactured a little exchange, and they printed it, and great. It would be a shame ever to be guided by the opinions of strangers, but especially when the opinions are, as they often are on the internet, like, mm-hmm. dishonestly rendered, you know, or just informed by an enormous amount of psychology rather than intellect. So I am not the kind of person who makes a point of not looking at those things. I just don't want to look at them. It doesn't interest me. I don't use Facebook, I don't use Twitter, I don't use whatever the other iterations of it are right now. Not because I think one shouldn't, but because for the same reason that I don't, like, you know, sit in shopping malls and watch people shop. It just doesn't interest to me. I don't judge people who want to spend their time that way. It's just not how I want to spend my time.
Are you as detached vis-a-vis what readers think of your books when it's out there, the novel? Do you just let it go and live its life, or do you like getting feedback from readers?
I like meeting readers a lot, and I like sharing experiences. I don't think that reviewers are special readers. I the person in, you know, in line who has something to say, like, I loved your book, or I preferred the other one, you know, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. Just to make that human connection is a really special thing, especially after having worked alone for a very long time. When I was in the cab on the way to the airport, I first took my kids to school, and as we were driving there, I said, don't you guys find it weird that I'm about to get on a plane, cross an ocean, go to another country where they speak another language, to talk about the book that I wrote in the dining room in that chair? And those people are going to read the book in their version of the chair, you know, whether it is in fact a chair or their bed or the bathtub. And I said, no, not really. But I find it really beautiful that there's all this infrastructure that separates those two intimate connection, or those two intimate activities. Like, there are reviews and there are interviews and there's microphones and audiences and interviews and all of this. But it's all in the service of, like, I did this thing in a chair and you're going to read this thing in a chair. I did this thing alone and you're going to do this thing alone. The richest experience, I think, as a reader, and the one that I would most want a reader of one of my books to feel, is that moment when you just feel known. You know, you're reading a book and all of a sudden it's almost like you're exposed. You feel so known. Like, the physicality of the book becomes more of the infrastructure that just falls away, and the author photo and the description of the book. And even the characters and the plot, it all just becomes unimportant or recedes. And what you're left with is this feeling of being known on a very, very deep level, on a level that's so deep that it has no relationship to the language you speak or the color of your skin or your religion or your age or even the period of time in which you live. You know, I went to Japan when I was, I guess it was about 15 years ago, and I ended up going to this garden, Tofukuji, in a shrine. I just kind of ended up there. I think I read about it in a guidebook, and I didn't know what to do on a certain morning. I'm not that into gardens, or I wasn't at the time. And I walked through the garden, and I just felt known. How do you explain that? How can a garden make you feel known? This garden was not designed by a Jewish person. This garden was not designed by somebody who had my mother. This garden was not designed by somebody who speaks English or checks email or lives in New York and grew up in Washington, D.C. This garden was designed by somebody who lived more than 1,000 years ago and didn't have electricity and, you know, writes in characters. And yet, I felt better known by that person. And it really is that kind of knowing. For me, when I read a book, I feel known by the author, even though I, of course, don't know the author and have never met the author. I felt better known by that person in that moment than I have by my brothers. You know, it's almost magical.
Is it akin to being at home, feeling at home somewhere? Is that what it's about? In the book, Jacob says, I want to be seen. Is it all in the same tone or in the same hue, all these concepts?
I think absolutely. Yeah, very, very much so. So all the characters in this book wrestle with home. Like, where will I be at home, you know? You could describe the book as the dissolution of a family, or the dissolution of a culture, or the dissolution of a transatlantic relationship, or all kinds of things breaking apart, but it's really not how I think about it. I think about it as people seeking home and kind of relentlessly seeking home, at any expense, and sometimes at extremely great expense. Mm-hmm. Sometimes at the expense of the home they had all along and just didn't realize.
Because in essence, it's on a deeper level than on these...
No, because they're mistaken.
Yeah.
Because the kind of emotional climax of the book is Jacob imagines pounding on this door to what he refers to as his sanctuary, but is really like his home on the other side, or his happiness. And he's pounding and he's pleading to be let in, not realizing that the door opens in instead of out, and that he was inside all along. And that's his tragedy. It's not that he could never find a home, it's that he was unable to recognize the home that he had. But books and art are certainly one kind of, they're a way that a lot of people in the world, myself included, feel less homeless.
There's much more we could be saying, or that I could be asking. I wanted to ask you about the use of double negatives in the book, for example, that are there throughout. But I'm definitely not the only one with questions, so I want to use the last couple of minutes to open to the floor to all of you. You can take the opportunity to ask a question. Not all 720 of you, I'm sorry to say, but certainly a few. There are two microphones walking down the aisles. There's a hand over there. It's coming to you. Please do state your name and ask one question, if I may ask.
Hi, my name is Isabel. Very nice to meet you. I loved the book, so thank you for writing it. I have a lot of questions, but I actually have one question that I will ask today. Where and how did you learn American Sign Language? Because everything you describe, how the signs are made, it makes sense. So I was very curious, and I told my deaf friends that I would ask you.
I didn't learn American Sign Language. I just learned enough. But you could be asking me, like, how did you learn how, 42-year-old woman prepares herself for bed? Or how did you learn how a 13-year-old masturbates? That one I can actually explain. Or how did you, by doing nothing else for an entire year, how did you learn how any number of things in the book? I learned it by doing the necessary amount of research, which is usually none, actually, and sometimes it's a little, to make it not true in a way that refers to something in the world, but true in a way that refers to your own sense of what's authentic. One of my first readings I did, a young woman stood up in the question and answer session, younger than you even, 14 or 15, and she said, how did you get that 80-year-old guy so right? Like, you got his consciousness exactly right, and it was so true, and you're not 80 years old. And I said, neither are you. Like, how do you know I got it right? How are you so sure I got it right? Did you take it and hold it up against your 80-year-old great-grandfather and see if they jibed? You know, no, it just was right to her because it passed her test. And it's very mysterious why certain people share certain tests of authenticity, like why the Japanese garden designer and I shared that test and that my next door neighbor and I might not. But so usually what I'm saying is there isn't anything in the world to refer to. In the case of sign language, there was something in the world to refer to, and I did learn enough to be able to get it right. Although the way I use it in the book and the way that I describe the hand gestures, I wasn't actually all that interested in the accuracy of it, but in the way that it felt to read the description of Jacob making the signs, I wanted it to feel emotional. There's nothing inherently emotional about somebody signing, you know? But in a context, and I could have described it in many, many different ways, like taking two fingers and running them down your arm. You know, there's just so many ways you could describe that. But I described it in a certain way to try to create a certain effect.
Thank you for your question. Somebody else?
There's somebody right here.
Here in the front row. Who gets there first? Left, right, left, right.
Hi, my name's Lotte.
Can you speak up a little bit?
My name is Lotte. I don't know if you can pronounce that in English. Okay. I really loved the way you said a bird is not an ornithologist? Yeah, okay.
Now we're even. I can't pronounce your name and you can't pronounce ornithologist.
Yeah, I can't pronounce difficult words. I'm sorry. And I was wondering if you, that level of consciousness is also something that bothers you when you're writing. For example, the many intertextualities that are constantly present everywhere, the many authors you read, many books you have read, is that a problem when you're writing that it gets very distracting or difficult or, yeah.
Did you hear what she asked? Okay. So, yes, it does get difficult. Like I feel like the more experience I have in the world, the more I have to resist. It's like a double-edged sword. Like on the one hand, it's all useful and I want it all. I want it all as material. I just don't want it as conscious material. I want it as like subconscious material, which is a tricky thing to ask of the world. Like I want you to influence me, I just don't want to think about you. So, you know, the best that I can do is to try to like repress a certain kind of questioning when I write. Like, is this smart? Is this stupid? Is this new? Is this cliche? Is this interesting? Is it boring? Or like, is this good? That's a question I really try never to ask. Would anybody like this? Do I like this? I really try to stay as far away from those questions as I can and to allow what wants to come out to come out. Now, the further I get into life, the more I have to resist. Also, the further I get into a book, the more I have to resist because it just starts to take a shape and there's no denying it. And not only is there no denying it, but you want to get to the end. It's like it is better to get to the end of a book than to stop halfway through. So the experience just changes as I go. And if the beginning is like really has a kind of reckless quality, the second half of the writing feels a lot more slow or thoughtful or deliberate.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Another question?
Hi, I'm Esther. In regard to the previous question, I was thinking about Tree of Codes. Was that a similar process, like reckless at the start and then more deliberate as you were going with Bruno Schultz's Street of Crocodiles?
So she's asking about a book I did in between my two novels called Tree of Codes, where it's kind of an art book.
I'll just show it for those who can see it so they have an idea. It's a cut-up book.
I took a book that existed. It was one of my favorite books, Bruno Schultz's Street of Crocodiles, and I like removed a lot of words, and by removing those words, the remaining words tell a different story. And no, that was a completely different process because I was so constrained by what was there, and it was so difficult to just even make sense, forget about telling a story that was interesting or beautiful. It was much more like filling out a crossword puzzle, like that kind of mental exercise, rather than like, you know, sketching something with your eyes closed.
Is it meant to be read cover to cover, or is it meant to be read as poems, so to speak? How do you feel about that?
It's meant to be read cover to cover.
Really as a story?
Yep.
Can you understand people find it difficult?
I mean, I often find very simple things difficult, so I don't judge anybody.
Could you cut it in another way too, or was this the one and only way?
Well, so the way I wrote the book was that I had a printout Street of Crocodiles, of the manuscript. I had like, I don't know, 10 of them bound in little spiral notebooks. And I took a highlighter and I would find phrases that I liked and then try to connect them. And then ultimately I had one version that kind of after doing a lot of those that told a story in a way that made sense to me. And then I took that to the publisher and we did the first one where actually a bunch of designers sat around a table and literally physically cut the first version of the book with X-Acto blades just to see what it looked like and to see how it worked. And as it turned out, it was good we did that because there were certain like problems with the way we had done it. It just was not appealing. It wasn't as good as it could have been. Like certain, you could see through all the way to the bottom in one place, which might sound good, but just it wasn't good. You have to trust me. And then we, you know, fiddled with it and messed with the margins and did another one, and then it was its final state.
Thank you. Thank you for that question. Two more?
Right, there's one right here.
Here, excuse me, there's somebody here.
Hi, I'm Sietse, which is probably even harder to pronounce. Sorry about that. I was wondering, I always kind of miss your characters after I'm done reading the book, and they stay around with me for a while. But that's after a relatively short time being around them compared to what your experience is. Maybe it's a bit of a romantic idea, but do they live a little while longer with you? Do you, when you eat your breakfast, think about what would Jacob do, or I don't know?
They don't, but you know, I don't know that they ever actually. No, it's not. There's nothing funny about that. I don't know that they ever live for me in the way that they live for you. Like, we are at opposite ends of this, like, the experience of a book. And, you know, for example, like, it is never a good idea for me to try to write about a mood that I am in. It just doesn't work. The mood stifles my ability to write about it. Then I write about it retrospectively later. If I'm feeling like depressed and I tried to express it through writing, it would not work. So I have to be calm and collected and find my way into it that way. But then hopefully for you, it will evoke the emotion. But it's not like an hourglass, you know, where you're one bulb and I'm the other bulb and we're just moving through the narrow passage of the words. I think we're having very, very different experiences. So for me, the characters are never really alive. I don't think of them that way. I think of it maybe a little bit more like, maybe like a painter with different colors of paint. And I like the way that I can use them to create a whole that I'm interested in, like a whole atmosphere or a whole just experience. But sometimes I'm not even so worried about their individuality. That might sound strange to you or even disappointing to you, but no. Like Jacob, Julia, in this conversation, am I keeping them perfectly straight? That's not really the point. In the same way that it's not really the point to get the sign language exactly right, I do need to get it right enough so that it doesn't preclude you having the experience that I would hope you would have. Like if I said he signed the symbol for water and punched himself in the side of the head. Like you would say, that can't possibly be the symbol for water. You've lost me. I need to not lose you, like to keep your trust. And so when doing a dialogue between two characters, I need to make sure I don't lose you and I keep your trust. But ultimately, getting two people speaking to each other correctly isn't all that great. Like I could take dictation of two people talking and transcribe it and you would probably be completely unmoved by it. If you were to read a transcription of this interview, whatever your experience was tonight, it wouldn't be so magical. Like it's magical to structure things in a certain way, which sometimes has to depart from how people actually talk. It has to depart from reality in order to evoke a feeling of reality or to evoke an emotion or a kind of authenticity to you. So that's what I'm interested in. And if I have to, you know, blur characters or make them say things that really no person would say right then. I mean, look, you know, like Oscar, there's nobody in the world like Oscar. He doesn't refer to anybody in the world or broad, or any Alex, you know. I take liberties in making them fictional characters, not to create vibrant characters. I don't care about vibrant characters. I don't care about exciting stories. I really don't. It's just I can't get the thing I want without them. So I use them to get the thing that I want, which is that kind of emotional experience.
Okay, great, thank you.
One last question.
Hi, Jonathan, I'm Casper. I was wondering, you talked about how when you write, it's more of just letting out your creativity. It's not really like something you have to consciously put effort into, maybe is how I got it. And how some of your friends have a completely different approach where they go, like, they pick a topic and talk about that in their book or write something about that topic. Do you think yours is a better way of writing?
I think it's better for me. They think theirs is better for them. And I mean, I may have oversimplified it a little bit. It's not as if I don't, I work as hard as my friends work. I think I don't know anybody who works harder than I do. It's just a different kind of work. You know, it's not the work of outlining how a story will be told and then like learning the detail, oh, this character's second cousin would be like this, and before 2 years before the book starts, this is what the action was. We'll never know about it, but I need to know about it as a writer. There are people like that. And it's just not my way. My way is to find the story through the process of telling it, and it requires a huge amount of work, like sitting down and writing. I mean, if anything, it requires more work because it's so inefficient, you know? On my screen on my computer, when I'm working on a book, I have two files. One is called novel, and one is called cast-offs, which is actually called vast-offs because it's just so big. And from the first day that I write a book until the last day, vast-offs has more pages than novel. And the deeper I get into a book, the bigger that discrepancy is. And when I end, you know, this book, maybe vast-offs was like twice as many pages or more than twice as many pages. And it's not mental garbage. It's stuff that I actually thought belonged in the book, but then I realized I was wrong. It doesn't belong in the book. So, you know, the Joseph Brodsky, the poet, said that the rhyme is smarter than the poet. Like, you can assume that you are the most intelligent party in the process, and then you will fulfill, if you do the very best you can do is fulfill your own expectations. Or you can say, I don't trust my own powers of observation, I don't trust the power of my imagination, I don't trust my storytelling abilities, I don't even trust my empathy to give me something that's good enough or sufficiently good, that's worth like devoting my life to, which is ultimately what I do. This is the only life I am going to have, and I spend it writing. So I want it to feel like it befits an only life, that the effort befits it and that the outcomes befit it. And so if I don't trust myself, I need to trust a process. There's this part in this book, actually, where Jacob hires a magician for Julia's 40th birthday, and he ends up having a conversation with the magician at the end of the party. And he says, what happens, by the way, if a trick gets screwed up? And the magician says, well, what do you mean? He says, you know, if like you ask somebody what card they picked and they just lie to you and they say a different card, or if you drop the cards and they spill all over the floor. And the magician says, well, I don't really perform tricks. I perform a process. So it can't really get screwed up. Like, it will go the way that it needs to go, and I can go in any number of different ways from the same starting point. There isn't any outcome that I need. And in a way, that's one of the things that really stifles Jacob, the character in the book, is there are always outcomes that he needs. He imagines an end and wants to force his life to down a path toward that end rather than just being open to a process. And when I write, there isn't any outcome that I need. I really hope that the outcome will be a book, and I hope that it will be a book that I didn't have to stop, that I didn't have to care less about in order to finish it. That's about as like firm a sense of my outcomes that I have. Otherwise, I can say nothing really can go wrong, you know, because for that reason, as long as I am not forcing myself to sit and work on something in the interest of finishing a book, as long as I am not relying on my own powers of observation and imagination. But if the rhyme, as I said, Joseph Brodsky said, the rhyme is smarter than the poet. You know, people write in verse because it's very pretty, but also because when you have to end a line with a word that rhymes with the word at the end of the line above it, you have like a problem. Have you ever written a poem that rhymes? Okay, most people have. So you know what that's like. Like, how the hell am I going to say what I want to say and end this line with a word that rhymes with ketchup or whatever? I just can't do it. But the solution to the problem is almost always more interesting and almost always a better expression of what you wanted to say without having realized it than what you would have done if you didn't have that problem. It's just you submitted yourself to a process, and that process produces its own strange results. You're welcome.
Thank you, and this brings us back to where the conversation started in a nice roundabout way. So this is all we have time for here. Thank you for your questions and for your presence being here, all of you. Jonathan Safran Foer will be signing copies at the Ticket Bali, so get in line, I'd say, if you feel like sharing a word with him. Thank you very much for being here, and most of all, thank you, Jonathan Safran Foer, for being our guest.
Thank you. Thank you.